We call this Maundy Thursday because on this night, Jesus renewed the mandate that we love our neighbor, but upping the ante by telling us to love one another, not merely as we love ourselves, but as he has loved us. Thank you so very much for being here to take your part in that love. Bless the Lord who forgives all our sins. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Gives us a pledge of eternal life, and who now lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Please be seated for the reading of God's holy word.
From the book of Exodus. The Lord said to Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, "This month shall mark for you the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year for you. Tell the whole congregation of Israel that on the 10th of this month, they are to take a lamb for each family, a lamb for each household. If a household is too small for a whole lamb, it shall join its closest neighbor in obtaining one. The lamb shall be divided in proportion to the number of people who eat of it. Your lamb shall be without blemish. A year old male, you may take it from the sheep or from the goats. You shall keep it until the 14th day of this month. Then the whole assembled congregation of Israel shall slaughter it at twilight. They shall take some of the blood and put it on the two doorposts and the lintel of the houses in which they eat it. They shall eat the lamb that same night. They shall eat it roasted over the fire with unleavened bread and bitter herbs. Do not eat it, any of it raw or boiled in water, but roast it over the fire with its head, legs, and inner organs. You shall let none of it remain until the morning. Anything that remains until the morning, you shall burn. This is how you shall eat it: your loins girded, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand. And you shall eat it hurriedly. It is the Passover of the Lord. For I will pass through the land of Egypt that night, and I will strike down every firstborn in the land of Egypt, both human beings and animals. On all the gods of Egypt, I will execute judgments. I am the Lord. The blood shall be a sign for you on the houses where you live. When I see the blood, I will pass over you. Then no plague shall destroy you when I strike the land of Egypt. This day shall be a day of remembrance for you. You shall celebrate it as it is a festival for the Lord. Throughout your generations, you shall observe it as a perpetual ordinance. The word of the Lord. Corinthians. I received from the Lord what I also handed on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took a loaf of bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body that is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." The word of the Lord.
Thank you. Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to John. Now, before the festival of the Passover, Jesus knew that his hour had come to depart from this world and go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. The devil had already put into the heart of Judas, son of Simon Iscariot, to betray him. And during supper, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, and that he had come from God and was going to God, he got up from the table, took off his outer robe, and tied a towel around himself. He poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel that was tied around him. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" Jesus answered, "You do not know now what I am doing, but later you will understand." Peter said to him, "You will never wash my feet." Jesus answered, "Unless I wash you, you have no share with me." Simon Peter said to him, "Lord, not my feet only, but also my hands and my head." Jesus said to him, "The one who has bathed does not need to wash, except for the feet, but is entirely clean. And you are clean, though not all of you." For he knew who was to betray him. For this reason, he said, "Not all of you are clean." After he had washed their feet, had put on his robe, and had returned to the table, he said to them, "Do you know what I have done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for that is what I am. So if I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have set an example that you should do as I have done to you. Very truly I tell you, servants are not greater than their master, nor are messengers greater than the one who sent them. If you know these things, you are blessed if you do them. Now the Son of Man has been glorified, and the God has been glorified in him. If God had been glorified in him, God will also glorify him in himself, and will glorify him at once. Little children, I am with you only a little longer. You will look for me, and I have said to the Jews, so I now say to you, where I am going, you cannot come. I give you a new commandment, that you love one another just as I have loved you. You also should love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples if you have love for one another." The Gospel of the Lord.
By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. You may be seated. The Christian faith was born in a Middle East already all too familiar with conflict. Born unwelcomed into an unwelcoming world. Born into controversy only to spark its own range of controversies. But the Christian faith established itself largely through its irrepressible love. "Look how they love one another," complained unbelievers about Christ's followers, according to the North African theologian Tertullian in the late second century. "Look how they love one another." That love, observed modern historian E.R. Dodds, was a major cause, perhaps the strongest single cause of the spread of Christianity. Nearly 2,000 years later, nothing's changed. Offering God's welcome, even where it's unwelcome, offering God's love is the only final answer to the hottest of the world's hostilities. That's what God's about. That's what we're about. A friend of mine, let's call her Margie, ministers frequently in North Africa. Tertullian's part of the world. A part of the world in which the Christian faith is largely unwelcome still and is altogether hostility-inducing. On a recent trip, Margie had been asked to bring a teaching for women in Christian ministry. And she writes this about her experience. I really struggled with what I should share with the women. I had prepared two messages, but neither seemed appropriate. During my restless night before my scheduled time to speak, it seemed that Jesus clearly spoke to me saying, "Wash their feet." But where would I find the basins and the towels? I shared my desire with the servant leader, and within a few hours, everything appeared in our upper room. I modeled the process with a dear sister who serves in a highly restrictive country. In humbleness, I knelt before her, and while washing her feet, I quoted verses of encouragement and prayed for her as I finished. We traded places. The Spirit's presence was very evident as we clung to one another in love and tears. Other ladies came and filled the chairs and washed each other's feet. There were many tears, but much joy. One missionary wanted to wash others' feet, but did not allow someone to wash hers. That night, when she shared with her husband, he knelt down and washed her feet. Another wanted to have her feet washed for her team member who was not at the conference. And when she returned to the country of service, she washed her feet. One of the gifts that we had brought for the ladies were bedroom slippers, not knowing that we would be washing their feet. When the ladies shared their experience with their husbands, the vision caught and spread. In fact, when the elders from that country visited church leaders in yet another restrictive country, one where there is military conflict and where the gospel is just struggling to regain a foothold, they knelt and washed their brothers' feet. Once again, the humbling, healing service was blessed. Through my friend Margie, it was as though the Lord were anointing an army of foot washers to wage a campaign that ultimately only love can win and will win. The way of love is the way of immersion. It's the way of observation. It's the way of listening. It's the way that Margie had learned over time, and that by paying attention to her Lord and teacher. She loved as she had been loved by him. She simply loved as he had loved. Then when she finally made her offering, its recipients made it their own and found a way to multiply it. For what Margie had observed was that in John chapter 13, Jesus acts out a profound parable of his extravagant love for us. You don't have to be a theological genius, nor alternatively do you have to fear being exegetically hyperactive to see the parallel between tonight's reading, John 13, and this past Sunday's reading in Philippians 2. There is to Jesus' taking up the servant's towel as Margie was to do 2,000 years ago. As Margie was to do 2,000 years later, a picturing of what his whole career had been, a laying aside of divine prerogatives to become a servant to us, to wash us from head to foot, from outside to inside, to clean places we didn't even know were there, much less that they were dirty. In Jesus, deity has bonded itself to humanity. Majesty has humbled itself to be born in our likeness. Infinite power has tethered itself to the way of obedience. Pomp has yielded to the circumstance of our desperate need, even to death on a cross. Oz Guinness once observed, "No other God has wounds but the Christian God. In the humility of his incarnation and in the abject humiliation of the crucifixion for which he was preparing his disciples in this act of foot washing, Jesus," to paraphrase Guinness, "Jesus so identified himself with men and women and the depths of their agony and shame and guilt that no one can now sink so low that God has not gone lower." Implicit in the foot washing is the picture of his redeeming love, but explicit is his call for us to do for one another what he has done for us. So if I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have set you an example that you also should do as I have done to you. Very truly I tell you, slaves are not greater than their master, nor are messengers greater than the one who sent them. If you know these things, you are blessed if you do them. May we know that blessing. Further, he puts it in terms of the new stipulation of the covenant that his blood is about to seal. I give you a new commandment that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you also should love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples if you have love for one another. Which brings us to page 274 of the Book of Common Prayer. Time to take your socks off. Do for one another what I have done for you, says the Lord Jesus. Of course, that's a call to an entire basin and towel way of being, of counting one another more important than ourselves. But here on Maundy Thursday, it's our practice to give people a chance to act out that way of being in symbol so that it can take deeper root in the whole of our lives. Now, we don't over choreograph the event. There are basins, there's water, there are towels up front. We simply invite you to come as you wish with bare feet, be ready to wash and to be washed. Now, some people come in pairs. Sometimes families come together and take turns, and sometimes people just get in line and just let this serendipitous thing happen of who's going to be around me so that they can wash my feet and I can wash theirs. Regardless, if you choose to come, may you serve Jesus in one another. Finally, as is often said by way of invitation to the washing of feet, anyone may come, no one has to come, and everyone probably should. Now to page 274. The bottom of the page, would you respond with the words in italics? The Lord Jesus, after he had supped with his disciples and had washed their feet, said to them, "Do you know what I, your Lord and Master, have done to you? I have given you an example that you should do as I have done." I give you a new commandment. Love one another as I have loved you. By this shall the world know that you are my disciples, that you have love for one another.
Please stand. The prayers of the people, Form 3, can be found on page 387 of the Book of Common Prayer. Father, we pray for your holy Catholic Church. Grant that every member of the Church may truly and humbly serve you. We pray for all celebrants, priests, and deacons. We pray for all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world. Give us grace to do your will in all that we undertake. Have compassion on all those who suffer from any grief or trouble. Give to the departed eternal rest. We praise you for your saints who have entered into joy. Let us pray for our own needs and those of others.
Kneeling as you are able, let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. Amen. Please stand. We have been forgiven that we may forgive, reconciled that we may reconcile. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Would you pass the peace? Welcome once again. Thank you for joining us. Whether you're able to be with us here in the cathedral or whether you're joining us online, foot washing is a lifestyle, and for some of us, tonight was the first time you've ever experienced this. For others of us, we've done it a few times, and yet it's so powerful and overwhelming. There were so many lovely Polaroid moments up here, but it would have seemed like profaning sacred moments to capture them. But may the Lord use tonight to impress more deeply upon you his great, tender, fond affection for you, and may you be a part of that army of foot washers that are his campaign to win the world in love. After this service, we invite you to leave quietly or to stay. We'll be stripping the altar, and then we'll have the reproaches, And then the cathedral will be open until midnight. The bulletin says 1 o'clock, but it will be till midnight. And you're welcome to stay and join us in the Garden of Repose to watch and wait with the Lord. And then the cathedral will be open again at 6 tomorrow morning for renewed prayers in the Garden of Repose. We encourage anyone who can to pray through the night at home. And then at 7:30, we will begin our Good Friday services. Then there, during this whole triduum of these 3 days of special reverence and remembrance of and participation in Jesus, the sufferings, the fellowship of his sufferings, and the looking to the power of his resurrection, may the Lord be truer and truer for you. And now let us walk in love as Christ has loved us and given himself a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. The Lord be with you. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, through Jesus Christ our Lord. For our sins he was lifted high upon the cross, that he might draw the whole world to himself. And by his suffering and death, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who put their trust in him. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love, you made us for yourself. And when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you, in your mercy, sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks, he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace, and at the last day bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Friends, the gifts of God for the people of God, take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. You'll find our post communion prayer in the bulletin. Please kneel as you are able and let us pray. O Lord Jesus Christ, in a wonderful sacrament, you have left us a memorial of your passion. Grant us, we pray, so to venerate the sacred mysteries of your body and blood, that we may ever perceive within ourselves the fruit of your redemption, who lives and reigns with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.